Beyond the Limit is brought to you in part by Nationwide. Nationwide on your side.
How much time do I have left?
If you do not have the strength to go to the summit, I don't want you to die.
I got plenty of oxygen to get me up and back.
You can't climb a mountain on your hands and knees. Now turn around.
I got plenty of leg in me, man.
Get out of the way, let's go.
What happens when a handful of dreamers take on the mother of all mountains? Strangers to each other, they share a dream they're willing to die for.
There's just something very magical about this mountain.
Biggest, baddest mountain in the world.
Only this man, a living legend, can make their dream come true.
Nothing comes for free here. Now the work starts.
In a two-month ordeal, eight heroic men and one determined leader struggle to the summit of courage and obsession.
We are leaving now.
This is Everest up close, as you've never seen it before. Through the eyes of courageous climbers and exceptional men, the team battles the mountain in one of the most deadly and controversial seasons on record. Climbers will lose fingers and toes to frostbite, and 11 die.
I wouldn't wish summit day upon my worst enemy.
People die.
The ultimate question of the ultimate climb, is Everest worth the price? A team of climbers have made a deadly wager. Their own strength and endurance against the mountain called Everest. Each knows he may never make it home alive.
Damn, let's get it on.
Very good, Daddy.
The team includes Terry O'Connor, an emergency room doctor from Oregon. Max Chaya from Lebanon. And Mogens Jensen, an asthmatic from Denmark.
This is huge.
Mark Ingalls is a driven man with lots of guts, but no legs. Brett Merrill, an L.A. fireman, is on his second attempt at Everest.
On we go.
And finally, Tim Medvitz, who made a vow to summit after a near-fatal bike crash.
I mean, it really wakes you up. Your life could be taken from you like that. Boom.
Each man has scrimped, saved, and sacrificed to make a pilgrimage few people in the world would dare attempt. A trek to the highest point on the planet.
This is the last great human adventure.
Just to reach the foot of Everest, take seven overnight stops to adjust to the rising elevations.
Get to see it. What a sight.
Ready to climb.
Base camp is already higher than any mountain in the Rockies. Here they have 1 week to prepare for the two-month campaign to the summit.
Don't forget the food.
They've signed up with expedition leader Russell Brice.
Nice gentle soul. They've got a dream. They've got an ambition to reach the summit up there. And if I can help these people push themselves to their limits for them to fulfill that dream and for them to shed a tear on the summit, then I've fulfilled my goal.
Russell Brice is a mountaineering legend. His daring climbs up Everest's most trying routes have made history. And he's taken more people to this summit than any other.
We've had 137 people on the summit of Everest.
A New Zealander, he's made the mountain his second home, and the Sherpas his extended family.
I know the Yak Men, I know the Sherpas, I know this valley. I've been here more than most white people.
Climbers come to Russell because he's never had a death on any of his 13 expeditions. The Sherpas call him King of the Mountain, but Russ knows better.
I'm not king on this mountain, man. No one's king. Only the mountain's king. Not us. We're mere mortals.
No insurance company on Earth will cover Russell's business. His only protection is knowledge, discipline, and the skills of his Sherpas, the backbone of any Everest expedition. But before the great climb begins, tragedy hits base camp.
One of our Sherpas died.
Oh.
So I'm sorry.
The Sherpa was hauling supplies to a high camp when he was struck down by altitude sickness, a threat to all Everest climbers.
He's a young Nepali boy. that worked for Pulver as his cook. And Pulver wanted to help him by bringing him here. We've already cremated him. That's finished, sorted. I've got to get back together again.
It's the first time Russell has lost anyone on his team, climber or Sherpa.
Okay. Let's get on with the job of getting up the mountain safely. Shall we go for a walk around?
Yeah. I've had to deal with a lot of bodies in the past, but this is the worst thing that can ever happen to me is one of my Sherpas die. So I'm pretty sad today.
Sherpa has died, and it's just a tragedy.
See Russell in tears like that, this strong guy who I look up to, and seeing them all breaking down like that, it's kind of humbles you a little, you know?
It's not going to be easy for us to start the expedition like this.
But Russell has no time to grieve. The weather loosens its grip on the summit for just 2 weeks a year, and his climbers must be ready. The climb to the top of the world is mind-blowing. From base camp, 3 miles above sea level, Russell's climbers must trek 4,000 feet higher to advanced base camp. From advanced base camp, they'll scale the treacherous 1,000-foot ice cliffs to a ridge called the North Col. And eventually, with a little luck, they'll make it to High Camp 3. But then, they'll enter the death zone at 26,000 feet. In the death zone, the air has so little oxygen and stress on the climber is so massive, the body eats its own flesh to survive, and the brain starts to crash. At the summit, the climbers face temperatures of minus 40 degrees, freezing exposed skin in less than 30 seconds, and they may not make it down alive before their oxygen bottles go on empty. This year, Base Camp sees 600 climbers in 71 teams competing for a chance to summit. The logistics of getting climbers to the summit are a nightmare.
It's a small village. We had 6 3-ton trucks. That's 18 tons that came this year. We got 63 people here for a month and a half. So it's a lot of food as well.
The cost to each climber is $40,000. It covers equipment, food, oxygen, and the wages of Russell's hand-picked army of Sherpas. The death of the young Sherpa is a heavy blow. The rest of the Sherpas won't set foot on Everest until they are blessed. Even the climbers join the ceremony, hoping for safe passage.
This is what they call the puja, and it's a Buddhist ceremony to purify the mountain, to ask the mountain gods to allow us to climb the mountain and come back safely.
As the puja ceremony plays out, even Russell can't predict what the mountain will throw at him next.
Every minute of the day, I'm afraid. We don't know what the weather's going to throw at us. We don't know who's going to have heart attacks. We don't know who's going to fall over and break their leg and just not be able to get back down. We have no idea of these things. There are so many things that can go wrong.
Fast forward a month, and they do.
I wouldn't wish summer day upon my worst enemy.
I think I made a mistake. I'm sorry. Desperately sorry.
It's ridiculous. Are people coming here to die?
At Everest Base Camp, Russell and his team hit disaster on day one of the expedition. After paying their respects to the gods of the mountain, they must move on.
It's all fairly symbolic. It means we can now get climbing on the mountain.
The climbers have spent a week preparing and are ready to roll. But for one, the challenge is unique. Mark Ingalls has a handicap that would stop most people from climbing a flight of stairs. Nevertheless, he intends to be the first man to summit Everest without legs. He's losing his voice in the thin air. but his new carbon fiber legs are working well.
I'll whip the mules. Dry the stumps off. Huge advantage to be able to do this partway through the day. Huge advantage. But it's working pretty damn well.
Throw the mark.
Before leaving base camp, Mark has some unfinished business.
Very nice to see you. See you again.
On a previous training climb in the Himalayas, Mark met Tile.
Tile and I are about the same age. We lost our legs in the same way. We both lost them through frostbite 20-odd years ago.
24 years ago, Mark was trapped on the summit of the highest mountain in New Zealand in the worst storm of the decade.
We sat there for 13 and a half days in total, and we lost 40% of our body weight. The other thing that happened, of course, was frostbite started to set in.
Mark's legs were frozen solid and had to be amputated.
The difference is that he's been walking around on his knees for 20 years. Yeah.
As his old friend smiles in disbelief, Mark fits him up with a second chance.
Look at this very tall man.
He's coming around pretty quick, huh?
Yeah, he's going very well. Stand up straight. Yeah, that's it.
That's great.
Whoa!
And look at the smile on his face. It's worth $1 million.
So happy to learn.
Oh, he's happy. Oh, very happy. It's good to see someone up front.
He hasn't walked for 20 years. This must be like, you know, a miracle to him.
Get out of this dust bowl down here. Get in some snow and ice and get it on.
Now, the time has come to climb.
It's brutally uphill.
So this is where it starts getting sticky.
Always late, but worth the wait.
This is their first objective, a freezing way station called Advanced Base Camp. Getting there means a 14-mile, two-day trek through a maze of rocks and ice walls. En route to Advanced Base Camp, the team climbs 4,000 feet higher. The air is so thin, helicopter rescues are impossible. A broken ankle will end a climber's dream in a heartbeat. And from here up, altitude sickness is a clear and present danger. Every 1,500 feet gained, the team must rest overnight and allow their bodies to adjust to the higher altitude. A fast ascent would be deadly.
If you were to go straight from sea level to the summit of Everest, get dropped off in some sort of magical helicopter up there, that you'd probably survive without oxygen, probably in the order of minutes to a half hour at the tops, before your brain began to swell, your lungs filled with fluid, and you'd essentially asphyxiate and go comatose.
As the men climb higher, victims of high altitude sickness are rushed down to base camp, more dead than alive.
It starts getting real spectacular with these 200-foot ice pinnacles and whatnot. They're amazing.
Pretty, yeah.
The climbers are less than 1/6 of the way to the summit. But even at this altitude, staying on your feet demands 22 cups of water per day.
Tired, cold, and I'm hungry.
And all sorts of high-energy food.
I'm eating this space-age complex carbohydrate polymer maltodextrin with sodium and artificial flavoring, and it's god-awful. Yeah, I'm eating gel and you're sucking eggs.
Yeah.
That's the difference.
That's the difference between Australia and America.
Let's try to keep international diplomacy going here, okay?
That's all right.
Yep.
The realities of climbing Everest are tough. But L.A. fireman Brett Merrill has dreamt of this challenge since childhood.
Ever since I was 8 years old, I've always wanted to climb this mountain. There's just something very magical about the history and the presence of this mountain. So it just got to be one of those times where, you know, okay, it's time to go. Sold the Harley, mortgaged the house, here I am.
With just 500 feet more to climb, Brett approaches Advanced Base Camp, also known as ABC.
ABC is a big step. You know, ABC is 21,000 feet or
6,400
meters.
ABC clings to the mountainside 4 miles up. For climbers, just arriving here is a triumph. The team rests here for 2 weeks to acclimate to the thin air. No one knows the agony of Advanced Base Camp better than Brett.
ABC, man, the land of misery for 2 weeks. Oh, brother. Just endure. Endure the lack of oxygen. You know, the lack of appetite, no sleep.
This is not Brett's first summit attempt. 1 year ago, almost to the day, he was forced to quit here at ABC after 8 nights without sleep.
I just started crying. I just remembered I was so upset, I was so disappointed, you know, I just knew that the trip was over with. I just couldn't go on any longer. It was one of the biggest disappointments of my life.
In just a matter of days, Brett's dream is in danger again. Advanced Base Camp is home for 2 months and packed with 71 other expedition teams. Everyone struggles to adjust to oxygen levels 50% below those at sea level.
Any exertions, any effort? For sure. Really fatigued and almost like you got the flu right now. Everything is sort of slow motion.
The body reacts to the lack of oxygen by producing more red blood cells. As a result, climbers absorb more oxygen per breath. But as their blood thickens, they are twice as likely to have a heart attack or stroke. The climber's greatest fear is known as cerebral edema. At high altitude, the brain can swell, causing disorientation, insanity, and even death. On Everest, even Terry, the team's doctor, can do little to help.
Our resources are terribly limited here. In fact, I tell many people that I'm not really a doctor up here. I'm someone that has a little more knowledge, someone that can give you some advice, but for real definitive care and to be a doctor, I gotta take you to a hospital.
If you want to
but even Russell, a 25-year Everest veteran, is hurting.
Put a plastic bag over your head and run up the stairs, that's probably how you feel. That's not a particularly good feeling.
You think twice about getting up to go for a pee because it's taking so much effort.
I mean, you gotta understand, in 48 hours, you're going up over 1,300 meters. You know, that's a good pump, you know?
Of all the team, no one suffers more than Brett.
21,000 feet does crazy things to your body.
Brett just really can't handle this hardship, can he?
I'm not going to worry about it because that just causes anxiety, and I've got a lot of other coping mechanisms.
It surprises me he's such a strong bloke. Or portrays that he's such a strong bloke, but maybe it doesn't. Maybe he's not.
I'm not going home. I'm staying.
Chronic sleeplessness, headaches, vomiting, and dizziness are symptoms of altitude sickness. It's so rampant at ABC, Team Dr. Terry is now helping teams who came here with no physicians at all.
Okay. What's the biggest problem do you think?
Headache. Essentially, it looks like he just has very bad acute mountain sickness. However, his oxygen saturation is actually pretty good.
A climber's saturation level shows how much oxygen his lungs can absorb from the thin mountain air.
Yeah, see. You know, our oxygen saturation's here after only about a night or two at 21,000 feet, looking on average probably about 60%. And as I was in the emergency department, someone walked in and their oxygen saturation was less than 90%. I seriously considered hospitalizing them.
But here, there are no hospitals. In Russell's camp, Everest cameraman Simon Wagan has collapsed.
You guys give me 1 second,
tense in dense pain. Okay, thank you.
It looks pretty serious. Maybe appendix or some internal rupture.
Simon just said he had a pain in his gut, and then it just got worse very rapidly. So, you know, within the course of 10 minutes, he was lying on his side, basically, in pretty serious pain.
Helicopter evacuation is impossible, but Simon must get down the mountain immediately.
He could get a basically a disseminated infection, his blood pressure could drop, and he could die from it, unfortunately.
Simon must be carried back down to base camp, 14 miles below. If his condition doesn't improve, he'll be driven 10 hours to the nearest airstrip.
You talk to Krishna and Tatapani to keep one place on that helicopter to go to Kathmandu.
Simon, you better get your boat back up here, huh?
The climbers now see for themselves. In the battle for the summit, Everest takes no prisoners.
Definitely a reality check. You know, I think we all know how this trip started. And now we're at ABC. Just don't know if that's the prologue to what's going to happen up top.
Day 20, Everest Base Camp. Cameraman Simon Wagan is recovering. The move to lower altitude has eased the pain in his gut. High above at ABC, everyone's relieved.
Tom Briggs. Well, here I am. ABC, 21,000 feet.
Home in Hollywood, Tim sells custom Harleys to the rich and famous.
Well, you're inside my tent right now, my home away from home.
Here, his ride is less glamorous.
That's the old girlfriend. This is the new girlfriend.
While Tim's spirit fits the climber's profile, his body shape doesn't. Unlike the short and wiry Sherpas, Tim stands 6'5" and is built like a bear.
He's a big boy. He should be playing rugby, not trying to climb mountains. That's a big bulk of frame to put up and down.
And since a near-fatal bike crash, Tim's carrying some extra heavy metal.
We got metal plate, 10 screws, metal plate, 10 screws, left knee plate from here to here, left foot, 10 screws. Lower back, steel cage. But when you look at the x-rays, the back looks like a metal waste paper basket. And my doctor thinks I should take up golf.
But in the game Tim has chosen, the penalties are fatal. Today, the team attempts their first climb to the upper slopes, a practice run to the first high camp and back to condition their bodies for the Everest summit. Russell's expedition tackles Everest from the north route, passing four high camps along the northeast ridge to the summit. At 23,000 feet, Camp 1, North Col, sits at the midpoint of a narrow bridge of rock and ice that joins Everest to its nearest neighboring mountain. But to get there, the climbers must scale this 1,000-foot ice cliff.
I think I've been sitting around for too many days. Breathing kind of heavy. You coming?
North Col, pal.
The trek to the North Col is a major leap in acclimation. But just a half a mile out of camp, Tim struggles with the extra weight on his damaged spine.
Just take your time, pal.
It's a damn steel cage.
The climbers move steadily upward.
Back's tightening up on me.
Tim's back there.
But Tim has completely fallen behind. This is crampon point. The last solid ground on the climb to the North Col.
Well, crampons are, of course, for the snow and the ice. It's a 12-point crampon. They grab onto the ice,
give you traction, give you stability.
Yeah, I brought one, you'll have to hop up.
Mark's crampons are accessorized attachments.
Jeez, I wish I could do that, mate.
Just crossing the flat glacier to the base of the cliffs is tough.
Definitely not my day. Legs are feeling very heavy. Keep going. That's all there is to it, I guess.
Minute by minute, the altitude sucks air from their lungs and parches the linings of the nose and throat.
Just track it along. Just track it along.
Tim has lost sight of the team and can barely walk. No one seems to notice Tim's absence as the team reaches the base of the ice cliffs.
No one said it was going to be easy.
The climbers now make a heart-pounding, lung-wrenching ascent up 1,000 feet of ice, broken only by bottomless crevices. Feet, the North Call is an agonizing reminder of how far they still have to go.
Adios.
As the team tackles the ice cliffs, Tim limps into Crampon Point, a full hour behind. Head guide Bill checks up on him.
Tim from Bill. Yeah, copy that.
My back ain't gonna make it. It's got that steel cage in there. Put too much weight on it. All that metal in there just kind of tenses up. Gives me a lot of pain.
Coordinating from ABC, Russell gets a report that Tim's struggling. It's up to Russell to decide who goes to the summit and who goes home.
You know, he's had so many motorbike accidents and he's got metal all over him and things like that. And he's a big boy. So a lot of energy to push that amount of bulk up and down.
I don't see
it. I think he turned back.
Tim now has no chance of catching up.
Tim from Bill.
Yeah, Tim, I think probably today we think it'd be best if you just came to the base of the lines and call it today. If you can stay off the lines, come over, take a break, and then maybe turn around and go back to the line. Just give us a call what you decide to do.
I'll call you when I get to the bottom of the roof.
We decided with Tim that it's probably just best that he comes to Crampon Point, puts his crampons on, comes up, tags the rope, and that's kind of his summit for the day.
Oh, it's horrible. It's horrible. It's like the rest of the Ranger won't be playing their games.
If Tim can't make it to the North Call, Russell will not allow him to make an attempt on the summit.
Everything's tough up at this altitude. I'm just so exhausted. I mean, I'm just walking and my eyes are closing.
Tim finally hits the wall and falls asleep.
He's the one I'm probably most concerned about at the moment. You can't just go halfway up and go to sleep. No, you've got to be determined to go up and down. So he's going to have a few issues to deal with in the next few weeks, a few days, a few hours. Got to work hard. It's nothing comes for free here. Now the work starts.
At 29,028 feet, the summit of Everest is literally breathtaking. The air contains just 30% of the oxygen that exists at sea level. By pushing themselves to the North Call, the climbers are teaching their bodies to adapt to the lack of oxygen. They're morphing themselves into Everest supermen, capable of climbing the mountain on a fraction of normal oxygen. But while the rest of the climbers rack up the training, Tim packs in the Z's. 22,300 feet, oxygen levels hover around 40% of those at sea level.
I'm tired. When I started off today, I didn't think I had the legs to get here. And I said to myself, Max, push yourself as much as possible so that your body can acclimatize. It looks I found some legs along the way because I'm almost there.
And so is the man with carbon legs, Mark Ingalls. The team is now higher than any mountain outside the Himalayas. And Brett has made it as well.
Hey guys. I'll tell you what, this is any kind of an outfit. They put an elevator in for six camps.
It's the highest he's ever climbed.
Yeah, this is basically the high point of my last trip before I bugged out. It feels good. What can you say? On the historic North Col, 23,000 feet. It's a stepping stone to the rest of the ridge behind me. Everybody made it today except for one.
1,000 feet below North Col, Tim radios Russell. He's thrown in the towel.
Hey, Russ. Kind of ran out of steam. Over.
Okay. Your decision. There's Tim. Tim is one of these people who will know sooner than later whether he's going to be able to go up the hill or not.
That's what you get for riding motorcycles too fast, I guess. You mean though? It's the body that I'm dealt with, you know? So, do it again tomorrow. Fat lady didn't sing yet.
After Tim's failure to prove himself, Russell lays it on the line.
If you can't go up and down North Col, then you're no right to be on my expedition.
Well. Just keep going, let's go to think it over and see where he is. I'm not saying that Tim's not going to make it yet.
All of Russell's other climbers have made it to the North Col. Even here, the team is still only halfway to the summit. North Col is as high as the climbers can go at this stage of acclimation. If they don't descend back to ABC, they run the risk of severe altitude sickness. As they inch down the dangerous ice, the team stumbles into a crisis at 23,000 feet.
I was just here, Terry on the radio. He's helping one of the Indian members. He seems to be suffering from pulmonary edema.
Yeah, your doctor is there.
Yeah.
He's checking about. I don't know actually.
Terry's up there. You can almost see the top.
Terry has rushed to the aid of a climber from an Indian team.
He's building a stretcher, and we're going to get him down a hill ASAP, basically.
It's extremely serious. He can die very rapidly. He went from basically standing to fully crumped over to unconscious in about 15 minutes.
Breathe. Yeah, breathe.
Spit it out.
Terry has no ER unit here, and the climber is dying in his arms.
When you see someone that's that advanced, the first thing in your mind is, well, this is a dead man.
At 23,000 feet, Everest expedition doctor Terry O'Connor has walked into his own nightmare.
His odds and his chances are actually pretty slim. He's certainly in an environment where it's very difficult for your body to survive in the first place.
A climber from another expedition is hit by cerebral edema, a potentially fatal swelling of the brain.
It's not that great, guys. I literally took, you know, the knuckles of my hand, and I put all my weight into his sternum. And he didn't even groan, didn't even respond. I mean, he was that far gone.
Breathe.
Terry has to save the man is a syringe full of steroids to slow the brain swelling. Russell's guide, Sean, takes charge of the rescue.
What we're trying to do is make a basket of rope that he'll sit in rather than be crushed into.
The man will die unless he's taken down the mountain and put on pressurized oxygen.
Indian members, any other clothes, cell phone, mattress, anything, okay?
One mat.
Yeah. Anybody who's sitting around watching, if you have any mats, could use one.
I don't have a mat. Get him, mat.
Yeah, Russ, go ahead. Yeah, we're about 5 from leaving, but I'll give you a call.
Make a neck roll.
Yeah.
Terry is extremely good at what he does.
Well,
very fortunate to have him on our team.
Position's okay. We'll just check out every once in a while on the way down. It's the best we can do. It's not going to get any better than that.
Yeah, we are leaving now.
Let's roll. Be careful. Need to be clipped in every person.
Pull. Slowly.
Slowly. There's too many freaking people on the rope.
Watch yourself.
You can overload the anchors, so, you know, I mean, we've got 2, 4, 6, 8 people plus the victim going down, and if they all clip in and pull on, that's a lot of weight on an anchor. We just need to be a little bit smarter. You end up with another dozen victims.
I said I was just here, and
he's a subordinary, can die quite quickly. So just fortunate that we happen to be there. We'll find oxygen somewhere. Indian Sherpas will run back up there pretty quick.
Over 13 years, Russell has mounted 15 rescue attempts. But on Everest, efforts like these rarely succeed. It takes 40 minutes for the oxygen to arrive. And it may be too late.
Can you help me? Because I can't really get myself in here.
Let's just let him quiet down here for a sec before I put a mask on. Are you okay? All right.
Come on, calm down.
Okay, good breath. Okay, you guys go ahead and get yourself set up. Let's get going.
After 2 hours, the team is only halfway down the cliffs and still 1,500 vertical feet above advanced base camp.
Keep going. This is not a good place to stop. Like, in the next 10 seconds would be f***ing great.
Helping anyone down a mountain can be the last nice thing you do. High altitude rescues put everyone at risk.
Okay. I'm living this up. Keep going. We need to come down that side.
Primary insult to cerebral edema is lack of oxygen. Same thing that's causing me to be short of breath right now after hauling him down. So we gave him a little dexamethasone to decrease the swelling and oxygen to stop the process. And he's still a little out of it.
He's not a well man.
It's taken the rescue team 3 hours to reach advanced base camp. Normally, a 45-minute descent.
Move this way.
Good one, Russ. Exactly.
At 21,000 feet, the man remains in critical condition.
I can probably get this clobbered off now.
So I have ultrasound here.
He's got a little bit of a wheeze and a crackle. So he has some pulmonary edema, too. Okay. I'm going to keep reassessing his level of alertness.
Climbing Everest is a very, very dangerous game. It's dangerous for us, it's dangerous for the Sherpas, it's dangerous for other people. We're going to see much, much more of this happen before we're finished this year with us or other teams. It's a pretty stupid game to be playing.
Next time, L.A. fireman Brett Merrill struggles for breath and fights for his dream.
This is kicking my butt.
Asthmatic climber Mogens Jensen proves he's the strongest and fastest.
Right now I'm looking at the summit, and boy, it's just huge and intimidating.
Double amputee Mark Ingalls has a mechanical breakdown on a sheet of ice.